Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this event. My name's Maruxa Martínez. I'm from the PRBB, the Barcelona Biomedical Research Park, quite close to here by the beach. And together with Natalie Bouslon from the Barcelona Supercomputing Center, and Aurelio Ruiz from the DTIC and the Engineering School, we are very, very happy to welcome you to this this event that we think is a very, very important topic. We're very happy to have a lot of people. There were more than 150 registrations, so we're very, very glad. And yeah, very happy to see that this is a topic that is important for so many of you, and good to see so many young people also, because you're the ones who will develop the technology of the future, so it's fantastic. So this event is going to tackle biases, gender and sex biases, racial biases, and any other type of biases in artificial intelligence and technology and its application to medicine. And of course, artificial intelligence is here to stay, and is already revolutionizing our world and revolutionizing medicine, but also many other aspects. And it promises, it has the promise, or it has the potential to create a lot of good, to make medicine or other aspects of life more efficient, faster, more fair for everyone. But that's if things are done the right way. If we're not careful, no, it has also the potential to maintain or even amplify biases that already exist in society. And this is what we're going to discuss today. We have a fantastic group of speakers from different backgrounds. So hopefully we'll have very exciting discussions, and we invite you all to also participate actively as the public. So we will have two short talks first to discuss what kind of biases are there, why there are these biases, what is the effect of these biases in the people affected. And then we will have two roundtables where we will discuss a bit about solutions. What can we do about these biases? And we invite you to, as I said, join the debate and ask and comment anything. So this started, the preparation of this event started like 2 years, no, more than 2 years ago, I think, no? Pre-pandemic, with Aurelio, and I really thank him for starting the ball rolling with a documentary that is called Coded Bias, which we will watch a short trailer in a minute. If you haven't seen it, I really recommend you to watch it because it's very interesting. And we wanted to do like a screening about this documentary and then have a debate. Then the pandemic came and many other things. And finally, we're here to start this event in a bit of a different format that we had planned, and with more people on board. So we hope that it's going to be more rich and positive for everyone. So I don't know if Natalie, you want to say something, and Aurelio also?
Okay. Thank you, Maruxa and Aurelio, and everyone to come today. I think it's very, very positive that we have this collaboration between the different institutions to show and connect also with the society and to change the science for a better future. So from the BSC, we are working in three lines, of course, to improve the numbers of women and underrepresented groups. So we are open to start with different policies. Also, the second level, we are changing our institution, our culture, and all the measures to have a more equity institution where diversity is a great value for science, and we know that, and we want to show this in our research. So the third level that we are working is in the research line, and this is why we have this group of sex, gender, and diversity analysis, and this is why it's connected our research, and today Davide and I will represent the BSE, and we want to follow this collaboration and in the future to organize another event. And we really appreciate the participation and also the dissemination of this type of event to build a better technology and to overcome the inequalities that we know that we have in our society. So thank you so much, and we are really open later to discuss and to follow in collaboration, okay? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So to close this start, so we are very happy from Pompeu Fabra University to welcome here, and from the School of Engineering, it's actually really nice to see that in a single event we have undergraduate students, postgraduate students, researchers from other departments, from hospitals, from companies, because the idea for this was to contribute to the ongoing discussion on the issue and to continue later and involving all types, the diversity of people, also including seniority levels. So without more introductions, we are going to start with the videos that Marusha mentioned. So thank you for coming.
During my first semester at MIT, I got computer vision software that was supposed to track my face. It didn't work until I put on this white mask. I'm thinking, all right, what's going on here? Is it the lighting conditions? Is it the angle at which I'm looking at the camera? Or is there something more? That's when I started looking into issues of bias that can creep into technology.
Our ideas about technology that we think are normal are actually ideas that come from a very small and homogeneous group of people.
Vast amounts of data at incredible speeds.
Everybody has unconscious biases, and people embed their own biases into technology.
This kid got stopped
as a result of facial recognition misidentification.
And then used that as justification to search you.
This is an innocent child.
Racism is becoming mechanized.
Systemic issues are only going to be hardwired into new technologies.
It's not just face classification, it's any data-centric technology.
Every day, we are all being scored.
Who gets hired? Who gets housing?
I am making predictions for your life right now.
The people who own the code deploy it on other people, and there is no accountability.
Management Analytic Towers wanted to install the facial recognition software.
Pretty much turned this place into Fort Knox.
The technology is being rapidly adopted, and there are no safeguards.
We are socially controlled in a way that we don't see.
Technology that analyzes faces could be biased, but the company is pushing it anyway.
What demographic is it most effective on?
White men.
Show me that it's going to be fair, that it's legal, before you put it out. That's what we don't have yet.
It's going to take people coming together, striving for justice in this age of automation.
Hello, healthcare. I just got back from Chicago Booth's Responsible AI in Healthcare Conference, and it's changed the way that I think we should look at bias in AI. I'm glad to say that you might already be familiar with AI bias. If you've seen movies like The Social Dilemma or Coded Bias, then you're off to a good start. If you've read articles and papers like Dr. Ziad Obermeier's Racial Bias in Healthcare Algorithms, then even better. But if not, we've got links down below that you can access, but I'll give you the short version. Algorithms that decide what movies we watch, or who we are, or even what healthcare services we need, show significant bias. This can be racial bias, gender bias, sexual orientation, socioeconomic factors, demographics, basically any opportunity that there is to display bias, we can count on it to show up in algorithms. Algorithmic researchers have really dug in on this problem. For example, there is a site called Archive, which hosts the latest papers in data science and machine learning. Between 2019 and 2021, the number of papers that are mentioning racial bias has doubled. So we see this interest from researchers, we see this interest from the media, but what can we actually do about the problems in algorithmic bias in healthcare? Well, that's what the Responsible AI Conference was all about. Dr. Emily Bembenek, who leads strategy for the Center for Applied AI, gathered folks like Dr. Alondra Nelson, who heads up the White House's Office of Science and Technology Policy. They gathered physicians, lawmakers, consumer advocates, big tech, little tech, even people from small startups like mine. Dr. Nelson kicked off the event by saying that these problems are well-researched and our principles are well-known, but how do we put these principles into action?
Okay, so with these two very short videos, we hope there's a few concepts that have been introduced and that we're going to discuss today more, and that, you know, has started to remove a bit something in there. We really recommend that you watch the documentary Coded Bias, and actually I think the other one, The Social Dilemma, they're both in Netflix. You know, I don't want to marketing, but they're easily available and very recommendable. So, without further ado, let me introduce our first speaker, who's Davide Cirillo. Let me tell you a bit about him. So he works at the Barcelona Supercomputing Center with Natalie, as she said before, and he's the head of the Machine Learning for Biomedical Research Unit. He studied pharmaceutical biotechnology in Rome, Italy, and then did a PhD degree in biomedicine here at the UPF. And working at the Center for Genomic Regulation, the CRG, which is one of the centers at the PRBB. And his research focuses on computational methods for precision medicine, with a special emphasis on machine learning, network science, and ethics of artificial intelligence. So very spot on for today's topic. He's a member of Elixir Machine Learning Focus Group, and he also co-leads the research subgroup of the BSC, the Barcelona Supercomputing Center, Bioinfo for Women initiative. And he's also a scientific advisor of the Women's Brain Project, which is a Swiss non-profit. And finally, he has co-edited a very interesting book titled Sex and Gender Bias in Technology and Artificial Intelligence, Biomedicine and Healthcare Applications, which hopefully, you know, this is a lot of expertise that he's going to try and send to us in 15 minutes. So thank you very much, David.
Okay, I will try to deliver this in 15 minutes. thank you so much for the invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here. And thank you for having me talking today about gender and racial bias in technology and artificial intelligence applied to medicine. Okay. Somewhere? Nope. It's better if I go there.
No, you can.
Oh. Seems like it's not working. Ah, this one, yeah. Okay. So I would start with an illustrative example, which was actually mentioned in the second video. This is a paper this is more complicated than, okay. This is a paper published in 2019 in Science by Obenmeyer. So it's actually the case of a commercial risk prediction tool applied to roughly 200 million people in the US each year. So it's something that is implemented in the American health system, is actually used. It's an algorithm that has been trained on insurance claim data of patients, and this data contains information about demographics, diagnosis, medications, detailed costs, and here is this. No, okay, well. So the algorithm has been trained with this data in order to predict the future costs that an individual is going to generate. So basically the total medical expenditure that a patient in the future is going to generate. So if this cost is very high, this person is automatically enrolled in a care management program, which is basically kind of a personalized predictive preventive program in order to reduce the health risks of this person, and so as a consequence to reduce the costs. So it is a very smart way, like you are predicting the future cost and then you do something in order to bring down those costs in the future. So for instance, in the case of an individual that comes from a community that has a significantly more illness burden than other communities, because it is known, for instance, that they have more chronic illnesses, more severe hypertension, higher cholesterol. So you expect this algorithm to predict that this person is going to generate high costs. But it's actually, it has been observed that not for Afro-American people, actually, the algorithm was systematically predicting low costs in the future. And so those people were not eligible for this special care management program. So why? Why is it like that? So it turns out that the data that the algorithm was trained on was actually doing what is written in the title of the slide. So what was predicting the health costs, but not the health needs, because this information was not contained in the data. So indeed, the data was telling that black people generate lower health spending than whites, about almost $2,000 per year compared to a white person. So why is it like that? How is it possible? If they suffer more chronic diseases, how it's possible that they generate lower health spending? Because basically they don't use the health system. And they don't use the health system because of a series of barriers to healthcare access, which generally are related to geography, maybe you know, duties towards childcare or jobs. They have less trust in the health system. And then on top of that, you also have the influence of a differential perception and discrimination of the doctors themselves. So as a result, basically you have in the data that these communities generating lower health spending. And so this is what the algorithm is predicting. So the interesting thing about this paper is that they actually changed the algorithm. And so just by substituting the prediction of those future costs with a combination of health and future and costs prediction, they yielded an 84% reduction in racial bias. So now it seems like this smart idea is working better. So this is an example of racial bias in the health domain, but actually it follows the same, let's say, scheme, the same pattern of many other applications in many other domains. So we see the same like in banking, in policing, in hiring, in retail. We always have some data that is chosen to train algorithms to make some kind of predictions, and those predictions turn out to have a negative impact specifically in a distinct group of people that can be identified by race, sex, gender, age, income, so on and so forth. So why it's like that? Well, it's like that because, unfortunately, we live in a world in which inequality and discrimination exist. And we saw before, we have unequal access and resource allocation. We have healthcare processes that are discriminatory by design. We have clinical decisions that are biased. And so if we are pulling out information and from this world in order to create our data, in order to create our data sets, this data is going to retain traces of those of these inequalities and discrimination. It's going to be a biased data. And if we use this biased data to train artificial intelligence system, the artificial intelligence system is going to be biased as well. And if we use this artificial intelligence system, we are basically reintroducing those inequalities and discriminations and biases in the society, amplifying them. So it's a kind of a vicious circle that we need to find ways to break. This is another example that is actually intersecting the categories of gender and race. This is also like related to the examples that we saw in the videos, right? This is a facial recognition system, actually three facial recognition systems that were developed by Microsoft, Face++, and IBM, and you see how they fail miserably in recognizing a specific type of faces. Now, if you think that, for instance, this is an algorithm for recommending treatments in four different subgroups of a disease, maybe this is working in three out of four, and then there is this one subgroup of patients that is going to be discriminated. So, and here is where precision medicine, at least for the application in the realm of biomedicine, enters the scene. So what is the relationship between precision medicine and artificial intelligence bias? So essentially, precision medicine, as you know, is aims at delivering better treatments for patients using specific characteristics of individuals or smaller groups of people, right? So those characteristics are demographic characteristics like age, sex, gender, ethnicity, genetic factors like mutations, family illnesses, the medical histories like medicines or comorbidities, and also importantly, the socioeconomic context like where this person works, where they live, what are the psychosocial factors that this person can be exposed to and can be determinant of the health status. Now, all this information can come directly from artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is very useful to get personalized information and to deliver personalized recommendations or predictions. And so there is this connection between, you know, precision medicine and how artificial intelligence is developed, and like both things can help each other growing. So here we have some examples of technologies that use artificial intelligence, and there are more and more uptaken by the health system, like for instance wearable devices that are able to monitor parameters, physiological parameters, or maybe algorithms that help radiologists to navigate the medical images. Of course, if we are able to identify through precision medicine different subgroups of people, we want those algorithms to be working well for each one of them. And this is the main objective of the field of machine learning fairness. So in the literature, it has been attempted many times, a comprehensive taxonomy of bias, but actually this is, in a way, it's also kind of pointless because, first of all, there are countless biases, especially cognitive biases, but also because our society is always growing and the technology is ever changing. So there will always be biases in the society. So a smarter approach to this categorization is given by Professor Baeza Yates at the Northeastern University. He categorizes biases into statistical biases, which are systematic errors or deviations from given distributions, cognitive biases that are deviations from expected norms or judgments of an individual, or cultural biases if those deviations come from a group of people. In a paper in 2020 that we published, we also ascribed some attributes to those categories of biases. So a bias can be as well explicit or implicit, expected or unexpected, desirable or undesirable. And you might think that, of course, if a bias is at the same time implicit, unexpected and undesirable, this can be very harmful. And this also can be very difficult to spot. But now you can think like, wait a second, what is a desirable bias? Why a bias would be desirable? So this is a kind of a strange concept, but it actually makes sense again in the context of precision medicine. So a desirable bias is basically a distinction that you want the algorithm to make in order to achieve a better outcome for instance, for women and men. In this case, we applied this concept in a paper that we published early this year, in which we trained a classifier to distinguish between male and female patient affected by Alzheimer's disease using digital biomarkers. Those digital biomarkers comes from an app for a tablet that the patient have to interact with. It's basically kind of a game. And while the patients are interacting with this tablet, a series of neurocognitive variables is recorded. And we use those variables in order to distinguish between men and women. What we discover is that not only it's possible to distinguish the sex of the patient based on this on those neurocognitive variables, which means that essentially, like in Alzheimer's disease, men and women start from two very different points. But it was interesting to notice that the classifier was less and less able to distinguish between men and women as more the neurodegeneration ramps up, right? So basically, they start from two different places, but then with the neurodegeneration, they end up in this gray area in which not even the sex is possible to distinguish between the two. Okay, so all those are examples of the fact that artificial intelligence act as a double-edged sword, depending on how you use it. So basically, algorithms can either magnify inequalities by integrating sex and gender biases, or they can reduce inequalities by integrating sex and gender differences. So you always have to think about the distinction between what is a bias or an artifact and what is a real clinically relevant difference between two categories, okay? Okay, here there are three solutions, not so easy solutions, that we have been working on. And let's start from the first, of course, is to, you know, ways of finding and mitigating those biases. And this can be done at different levels. For instance, we focus on technologies and focus on the data. So on technologies, we publish a survey on the status of bias in different technologies that are used for precision medicine, like, for instance, natural language processing, robotics, digital medicine, and big data analytics. The important thing here is that there are a lot of debiasing methods which are specific of the different technologies. So you don't have like a universal method that works for everything. You really have to be contextual, okay, when you find those solutions. In the case of the data, in the context of the Elixir Biohackathon Europe, this is a big event, a hackathon, we analyzed the content of metadata of two of the largest human data repository in the world. So the first one is DBGAP, is from the US, and the second one is the European Genome Phenome Archive here in Europe. And essentially, we were looking at the status of reporting the sex of the samples. So those are databases in which experimental people upload the data. When they do an experiment, when they publish a paper, they upload the data there. And this must be accompanied by metadata. But it turns out that in most cases, like, there are a lot of unknowns. So basically, those experimental people are not reporting correctly these categories, and this is especially true in the case of US. You can see this. I mean, it's difficult to read, but you can see this from those lines that are very flat and very high. This means that you always have unknowns and mixed things. In the case of Europe, you can see this blue line that starts very up. Those are the unknowns. And then it goes down around 2016, 2018, and the green line goes up. The green line is the one that indicates that female and male are correctly reported in this data. And so this switch happened around those years because the database itself forced those experimental people to report correctly this category. And so you can see like the difference, not like some years before and some year after. This is not done in the US, and so we are still in this situation. Okay, so again, in the context of this big event in 2021, we also disseminate a questionnaire asking about for instance, like questions like this: how familiar are those computational biologists that are using those databases with the guidelines and the best practices related to this matter? And as you can see, this is a problem of awareness raising, because in the majority of the cases, they don't even know that those guidelines exist. And those guidelines exist. Like here, there is one. This is from Gender Innovation, that is kind of the reference in this area. And here are just like a roadmap in order to perform analysis that are focused on sex or focused on gender. So these kind of things exist. That's important as a second solution to raise awareness about this. And then, okay, another way of raising awareness is to write books. And so here is the book that that I had the honor to co-edit together with Silvina Catora Solarz and Emre Guni. It has been praised by important figure in the field, like Londa Schiminger from Stanford, and it received contribution from both academia and the industry. So the final solution and the final slide is about the regulatory aspects. So in this summer, we had to present some policy options. We have to write a report for the European Parliament and present in Strasbourg this, that are policy options in order to address bias in databases. So without entering too much into the detail for the sake of time, but essentially it's important to understand that this is a problem that needs to be addressed at the level of the regulations, but we don't need to create new laws that will take forever before they are going to approve. And this is because, for instance, at the moment there is the AI Act that is, you know, a new regulation about artificial intelligence that is currently debated in the European Parliament. So what we are proposing is like, okay, find the space inside this AI Act to also address biases, respecting the transparency rights of the users and stressing out the importance of data collection and database certification. So, okay, conclusions, there are those inequalities that can be reflected in the data, and be careful when you use this data to train algorithms. Those biases can seep in at a different level of the life cycle of the development of artificial intelligence and implicates all the actors involved, not only the developers, but also who use the tools and who takes decisions about the tools. AI is a double-edged sword, so remember bias and differences. And then the solutions, well, those are just three, bias mitigation and detection, awareness raising, and regulations, but there are many other. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, David. That was a super interesting presentation. So for the sake of time, we're not going to ask questions now. David will be in one of the roundtables later. So keep your questions and then we'll discuss them all together. And that was a very nice link to our next speaker. When you mentioned the Artificial Intelligence Act being debated now at the European Parliament. So our next speaker, I think we're very lucky to have with us, although virtually, is Oyedilla Oji Palino. She's joining us from Brussels. Hi, Oyedilla. She's a policy and advocacy advisor for digital rights at ENAR, which is the European Network Against Racism. And she's actually precisely focusing right now in the AI Act developments and advocating for the implementation of rights-based and inclusive principles in this act. So from ENAR, she's trying to, you know, having also relationships and developing relationships with EU institutions with a racial equality lens. And before this, she researched and mapped projects of resistance and reappropriation of technology with a special attention to artificial intelligence. So it's an honor to have you with us, Oyedilla, and we're looking forward to hearing about the work you're doing now and also your views and experiences of this topic we're discussing today. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Marusha, for having me. For me, it's an honor to represent ENAR in this such important event, because actually I'm from Barcelona, but I moved recently to Brussels to take this position. And I think that health is one of the fields in which technology has been exponentially been applied, and especially AI, and also because of the excuse of having the pandemic as an excuse of harvesting more data, because we wanted to, of course, predict how the disease was going to be spreaded or not during, like, especially those peak moments in which we didn't know exactly what was going on with this, with the pandemic, its consequences, to how many people it was going to affect. So yeah, I mean, we all know what was happening. We all been like super updated with this kind of information day by day for at least 1 year and a half. Now it seems like we are not doing it as before. I mean, we are not having this kind of information as before, but it's something that it is existing, and we have to take into account that this information that we already have now has been developed for many years in order to provide us with this information in the end. So today I want to talk a little bit about different aspects of how we are trying to tackle with racism and in artificial intelligence, and in this case, in the application of artificial intelligence in healthcare here from Brussels. First, I would like to highlight that racism is something that it exists in Europe, and it's something that it's intrinsical inside of the how Europe and how the European society works. It's something that it's already embedded, and that we have to acknowledge first about it. And by acknowledging this, we already can recognize and we can try to tackle all the problems that brings racism to our society, like, for example, biases in AI. Because racism, in the end, it's something that we already have inside of ourselves. It's not that there's people with bad intentions trying to design AI systems. It's just that we conceive our realities in certain ways, and when we are trying to design, to, for example, harvest the data, design the product, and after implementing it, in this case, in hospitals, for example, or when we are trying to provide health insurance products, this is something that we already been transferring from one side to another. And this is something that comes from us. It's not something that it's magical and that we don't expect never to happen. Of course, we always think that the most important thing, or that the best thing would be to just have one product that works for everyone. But in the end, this is something that it's not possible, because we are all completely different. So, for example, if you understand that a man and a woman, for example, have completely different needs, why don't we think the same for example, with people when we're talking about race? And especially when we're talking about healthcare, it is a sector that historically has been really linked with the sense of taking care of certain communities more than others, and how these have been marginalized. For example, the universality of having a good healthcare system, for example, is something that we already understand that it's our right. But by normalizing this, by making it universal as a universal law or right, we are still forgetting that there's people who are not getting this, and that also we should take care of these people, because at the end, it's something that they are part also from our society. And we have seen this, for example, with COVID-19, for example, that if we were not taking care of certain communities, we would have the danger of spreading the disease if we were not protecting all of us, right? So this is something that we should take into account when we're talking about health and how we should try to tackle, like, really the biggest problems, or the problems that are completely embedded when we are trying to make that AI work for everyone. So, for example, in my case, as Marusha was saying before, I'm working on the EU developments on the AI Act, which is a document, or it is a regulation that the European Commission created the first draft. And from there, for example, from the European Commission, it was passed through to the European Parliament. And at the moment, this is something that it's being discussed, and it is being discussed. And then the only thing that they are doing at the moment is just creating amendments to the document in order to have, like, a better perspective of the appliances of AI. For example. So let's say that at the moment there's a committee. I mean, when we have a regulation that has to be amended, for example, we always work, or the European Parliament always works with committees. In this case, the name of the committee is called LIVE and IMCO. And for this group, there are two people who are in charge of the amendments, to make agreements between the amendments. So, for example, for the healthcare system, there has been, like, different civil society organizations that they have been trying to work on this, to make amendments in order that health can be something that can be used with AI, but taking into account the risks that these systems are providing also to some certain kind of people or to people in general, because we never know if this is going to happen to us, right? So, for example, there's one group which is called the Health Action International, which are based in the Netherlands, if I'm not mistaken, in Amsterdam. The thing is that they created a statement with all the things that they felt that they thought that this AI Act should have in order to make sure that that it can be for everyone and in a way that can be safe. So they've been really involved in negotiations and votes in order to make this this approach better. And the thing is that this organization, the Health Action International, HAI, already got like really good improvements of the draft of the AI Act, and their proposals were already included as amendments inside of the document. But the thing is that the amendments doesn't say anything, because in the end, the final draft or the final document can be already released without the amendments that they've been doing during all these months. So during this year, we have been trying to ask for many, many changes. And at least this part of the demands that the Health Action International was trying to make pass. At least they were successful. And they were saying, for example, that all the systems in which we already know that the AI is involved in healthcare should be rated as high risk, because the AI Act, one of the things that it does is that they classify in different levels of risk all the systems that we are using at the moment with AI, and high risk is the highest. And for each kind of risk, we have different ways of tackling the problem. So, and in this case, when they were talking about categorizing AI health systems as high risk, they were including public health, pharma, and well-being. Well-being in terms of specifically of apps, I think. So yeah, and from there, for example, they were also wanting to narrow the definition of health, because they had the feeling that it was super broad, and in order to just have a very strict definition of health in which we are not only talking about physical harm or something that can be like that could have an effective remedy, but also thinking about mental health and physical health, and not only the absence of having a certain disease or something like that, right? And another thing that they were asking is to provide a fundamental rights assessment, risk assessment, which is something that we are actually asking in any other kind or in all kinds of applications of AI, which is something that at the moment the regulation is not taking into account. And that we think that it's really important, because if the fundamental rights are not being taken into account, what kind of regulation are we passing in the end to the EU's EU countries? Because in the end, after the legislation is approved here in Brussels and at the European Parliament, it will go back to the Commission, and the Commission will tell the EU member states to already implement this legislation in their countries. And also, for example, they were asking the HAI prohibition of social scores, specifically for private sectors, like for example the healthcare insurance, which is something it's a practice that they've been doing very regularly in order to provide like certain kind of services to one community or to one people and to another, depending on the scores that they were having. So I think that this is something that it's very important, and that we should try to take into account that Europe is doing something about this, but probably as Davide was saying, not fast enough. So for this reason, I think that we should all, like nowadays, we should try when we are trying to design a new AI system, it is better to have a design which is thought from bottom up instead from up to down. Because if you're trying, because in the end, we should try to make sure that all the communities are involved, or that we don't have different systems for different communities. Instead, we should try to have one that is really working for everyone. Because what is it doesn't make any sense that we use AI systems that works for one people or and not for others. Because it is not for, I mean, it doesn't make any sense for me, and especially because many of these kind of approaches, they already know that it's not working for certain communities, but they don't care, and they still continue selling this product, selling it to hospitals and to many other kind of institutions in order to continue with this with the business, right? So, and we also have to think that, for example, hospitals, they have in many cases, a really strong collaboration with big tech companies, like, for example, IBM, Google, and also laboratories. So we have to make sure that this relationship, we really know what these big tech companies want from all this, why are they interested in certain places to be part of their projects or to test their projects, right? So, and also one of the things that when we try to design or we try to think about healthcare and how to improve healthcare, one thing that is very important to know is to revisit the concept of pain, because pain is something that is very personal, but we know that historically pain has been or the concept of pain, especially for people who are from racialized groups, has been undermined. Thinking that we can, like people of color, can cope with pain more than others. So that's why we give them X, Y, or Z kind of work. And because of that, they can wait, for example, more hours attending when they have to go to the hospital to think and to wait a little bit more. They can wait more to have a room, for example, or we can give them this medicine instead of the other because they can cope better with pain. And this is something that it's very wrong to do that. And it is something that it's already embedded in all the data that we are using in order to train all these AI systems. There are many conceptions of doctors about racialized communities that are already inside of the data. And let's say that we are working with data from the past, and the past has been not working well and not being really good at providing information or providing cure, especially for people of color. And one example of this is the dermatologist. If you by any chance you have the chance to study a little bit about dermatology, you will find that all the cases are applied for white people, and this is something that, for example, people of color they know already that if they have to go to the doctor when they have to go to the dermatologist, they will wait like for a long time because they don't have any kind of information, and when they are going to the doctor. Or because they know that the doctor is going to give them a remedy that it doesn't work for them, and it's not until their case it's in a really bad moment, or that it is so bad that they know that this is not working for them, that it's something that they cannot do any other thing, and it's too late for them to have a remedy for something that before it was very little. And that in the end, well, it's something that it's super, let's say that it's so wrong or it's so bad, the state of their skin that it has been developing, for example, cancer and all these things. So, for example, we have at the moment skin cancer algorithms, but we know that they are primarily trained on light skin individuals, which is something that, well, it's okay, but when then you ask them, hey, does it work for everyone? Then they tell you no. And many times, these kind of products, they are telling you, yeah, these are super okay. We have an efficiency of, well, I don't know, 90%, but what kind of 90%? 90% for everyone or 90% for certain people? For example, we also had an example of breast cancer studies in which they were using pictures of women in order to detect, in order to create a model that it was detecting skin cancer through pictures. They were using 10,000 images, but most of them, they were from white people, from white women, when we have to think about that that black people have 40% more probabilities to die from from breast cancer in this case. And in this case, in this study that it was done by the MIT, they were not thinking about it. They were just saying, okay, let's do this project, let's try to develop it. And after it was released, they understood that, hey, there's like a very strong number of people that we are just removing from the, or putting aside, because we didn't think that breast cancer is affecting more people, like in a higher percentage or in a stronger way to certain communities more than others. Or, for example, for the allocation of patients, we know that there have been deploying certain kind of systems in which, instead of saying, okay, who's the person who should be attended first because I don't know, they have a good emergency and that they should be allocated first at the hospital. Instead of having this kind of approach, they were having another approach completely different, which was, who can afford to pay this remedy or these medicines or this treatment? And of course, if you are talking about who can afford it, always it highlights that the best person or the best people to afford it are always white people. And one thing that I will also try to talk about is about how mental health apps are working at the moment. It's something that we are using. Many times we are using it because we don't know, it is very difficult to approach to another kind of, to people and to talk about it, or even we cannot afford to have a psychologist because we don't have the money. And especially if we are young, we cannot have the money to work with it, right? So we should take into account that when we are using this kind of apps, these companies are already retrieving our information, and that they are using it for when they are selling it to other companies, that at the same time they are selling it to others. And in the end, our information, we don't know where it is. And this is something that is happening with free apps and with apps that you have to pay. So in the end, it's something that we should take into account, and that we should also try to find out the way in which we can use AI, AI in health, but without reproducing some certain kind of things that have not been working in outside of the online space. So because this is something that we as people of color, we already understand how the healthcare system works, and that we know that certain kind of services are not working for us. And when we are trying to use technology in order to improve the services, we're trying to improve the services for who? For white patients, for the hospital, in order to not recruit more people. So we should try to ask certain kind of questions in order to understand who is it benefiting from the use of AI tools in healthcare. Because the only thing that I have for sure is that the ones who are always benefiting are big tech companies. And apart from that, we will see if others are really profiting from it, and if there's a benefit for all of us in the end. Because what I think is that if it doesn't work for everyone, we have a mistake. We must try to handle this problem, and also to put as many people in the table as possible. Because I can talk, for example, for my community, but I cannot talk for others, and probably others are facing other kind of of problems that maybe I'm not taking into account, because we are not perfect, and of course we cannot have a 360 degree point of view of how healthcare should be. But for sure, it's something that we should take into account, and that that for sure we need more discussions, like for example this one, in order to approach more people and to understand which are the challenges that AI systems give in the healthcare system and how we should be careful of using them, and of course not letting them just work alone, always with the supervision of a person, of a doctor. In order to make sure that the decisions that we are doing are just shared with the machine and not only by the machine. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yedija, for your very interesting talk. She will be taking part in the second roundtable. We'll be having now, so you will have the chance to make her questions about it. So you provided very important problems and impacts, no? And also mentioned, no, the important legislative moment we are living now, no, where we need, no, to guarantee that indeed the legislation works for all, and that's also part, no, of all of us as citizens, no, members of different communities. So we are going to start two roundtables now. The first one is going to focus on technical aspects of AI bias, and the second one is going to take the broader social impact, no, of biases in technology and medicine. So I'm very happy to introduce Oscar Cámara, who will be the moderator for this first roundtable, where we will have also Davide, Paula, and Manuel. If you can already come to the table, I will briefly introduce you. Before introducing the speakers, in this part, no, they will start having the discussion in the round table, no, to warm up the discussion, but we strongly expect you also to take active part there. I have to recognize I have also a bias here, and it's towards students, so I would be really happy that you feel invited also to take part in the questions and interactions with the speakers. So the table will be moderated by Oscar Cámara. He is a full professor here at the Department of Information and Communication Technologies at UPF, and he's acting also as the Dean of the School of Engineering. So he has been extensively working on signal and image processing for clinical applications, and leads the Fisens group, who's specifically working on that. No? Table we have, we already introduced Davide, who's working at the Barcelona, we reminded, no, the leader of the Machine Learning for Biomedical Sciences group at the Barcelona Supercomputing Center in Barcelona. Next, we have Paula Subias, who is a data analyst and researcher at Eurocat, and she's also pursuing a PhD in the Bioethics and Law Observatory of the Universitat de Barcelona. And to the left, we have Manuel Portera. He's also a colleague here at the Department of Information and Communication Technologies and UPF. He's a postdoctoral researcher at the Web Sciences and Social Computing Research Group, and he's been very active also in promoting initiatives that he may explain later. So thank you all, and so the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Aurelio, and thank you, the organization, for such a needed event. And I think this is something that is going to be more and more needed, in particular for the young people and the engineers and clinicians. I have a lot of questions to the table members, so please stop me and contribute. Otherwise, I won't stop. Huh? But I would like to just start mentioning that last week we had a very special visit here at the department of Richard Stallman. I don't know if you know, he is the founder of the GNU, and the GNU is the system together with Linux that a lot of people are using, and he is one of the pioneers and advocates of free software. Free, as he says, not as gratis, but libre, no? And this is quite important and nice in Spanish. And how difficult was for him to be out of the system, out of a system that force you to give your data, to big companies. He doesn't use Zoom, he doesn't use Google, he doesn't use credit cards. And he was explaining, and it's just crazy, the sacrifice that you need to do in order to be out of the system. It's just completely crazy. I just wanted to start with this because this kind of collection of data, and in particular in health, is one of the parts of the problems. And let me start asking Paula about this data, right? Who does need to control these biases in the algorithms and the data use? I mean, who is going to control the companies, the users? Does it need to be the users, organizations of users, governments? And this is in relation to who is the owner of the data and this traceability that she was mentioning at some point.
Yeah, thank you. Can you hear me? There is a chaos of chairs. Yeah. I think that's a very good question. It doesn't have a very straightforward answer. As Oye was mentioning before, the European Union is trying to change the paradigm to set a framework to allow, thank you, to allow citizens to be the data owners. But as of now, that's not the case. And I think there are very few companies or very few organizations that are ready to make that possible. I'll say that, I think Oye said something before about making that changes shouldn't be up to down or down to up. I think that's actually how it works. I think that's how it is. And what we lack now, I'll say, is a culture of data ethics or about the what is a good data framework that we should all know and we should all demand. Because I think changes will only happen if all of us do enough power, enough pressure for things to happen, right? Like if citizens are not empowered, companies will not enforce anything because there is not a real need for that. And if that doesn't happen, then there will be no need for a law to occur, right? So I think there is a long path still to happen. But yeah, I think now, unfortunately, we are not the data owners of our data, but I hope that with the changes that the AI Act and the GDPR and other regulations that have been empowered and a lot of guidelines that have been created in order to provide this ethical code that we should have in order to demand changes, I hope we make there, we get there some point.
Let me be super pessimistic. Which are the resources of a theoretical agency that we'll need just to make sure that these laws are fulfilled? This agency needs to go and check every company, every research institution in all countries.
Yeah, I think ideally, like now there is some work, there is an agency for auditing purposes at the Spanish level. If that happens and that properly works, I think that will be a very good mechanism in order to be sure that we are compliant with how things should be. We are not there yet, so I don't know. But I think ideally, this kind of independent agency should be the one that auditing the process to allow, well, to guarantee that we live in the world that we want to live.
Really, David and Manuel, whenever you want to comment on this, just go ahead.
Yeah, maybe like it's like the interesting thing here is also you know what we already have in place. Especially in terms of who controls, you know, who check, you know, the norms are complied. What we have right now, the drugs, right, the medical devices, like we have this kind of regulations, no? Maybe like, you know, some kind of inspiration from what already existing applied to algorithms can be done. Of course, it's like two different universes, right? I mean, it's completely different approach. But still, like in this case, there are agencies for, you know, that check if you are complying with the regulations that have some form of apply some form of control. So this is a parallel that always intrigued me because it's somehow like very 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 closely related in a way, like at least at the abstract level. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And another point is about the citizens, no, and so there are a lot of initiative that goes in the direction of data altruism. That is very interesting. So this is basically I am a citizen, and I decided that I want to donate my data for a specific research project. And so I am informed about all the details of this project. I give my consent. There are some intermediaries, but I'm not selling my data to companies, or like it's more, you know, a way of going directly to give my data directly to research project for which I have fully informed. So this is another, like, let's say, way in which this can be done, that it's a bit more focused on citizens and you know, like how much informed they are. Yep.
Davide, do you see like really new technologies like blockchain or whatever similar that could be useful for this traceability? And do you see that this have the potential to happen?
Absolutely, absolutely. Actually, the associations that do this, like this data altruism, they use blockchain technology so to have, you know, like to comply with privacy, with security, and also to have some kind of traceability. Yes, this is definitely one way to go.
So yes, regarding data governance, right? This is an important topic. Now, currently, we have the Data Governance Act from the European Union is entering into force now, and then we have this data altruism, but also data intermediary services that can work like institutions that protect the interest of everyone, and this is particularly interesting in terms of health data, right? So how we train algorithms and how data is protected, because the truth is that, okay, we can train an algorithm and we need data from everyone there, but at the same time we don't have to ask for their data, right? And that's how we manage that. That's really important and tricky in some way. So we don't have the answer, and blockchain or whatever could work, but also who controls the network, right? So this is kind of tricky. Yeah, I agree with you, but we have to try, right? And another thing is related to what you have said, that the free software or free movement, is that for many big tech companies, they got power because there's a lack of alternative, right? Because Gmail is Gmail because there are no alternative. Now it is, but at the time, isn't. So maybe the free software movement was, okay, we can create alternative for, and many people today use Ubuntu or many other software, right? So is it possible? But we have to be one step forward, right, in that topic.
Exactly. And Davide, I would like you to comment, because, I mean, from one point of view, we all agree that we need to have better databases, less bias, more balanced. That means that we need to get data out of a local environment, and we need to aggregate different databases from different places. This is from one side. And then the other side is that difficulties, increasing difficulties to share data with the GDPR laws, and I had some conversations with, I call it lately, the data inquisition officers, not the data protection officers, because they always say no to whatever you propose, right? Because they want to be cautious. But to some extent, this is making life of researchers difficult. So we have two competing things, right? I mean, from one side, we need to get more data or more balance. And from the other side, we get more difficulties to do it. I mean, do you see any potential technologies to help on this?
Yeah, this is a big problem because we are always, you know, in this situation, right? Like you have, you know, the willingness and the resources and the ideas to develop things, and you need data maybe from hospitals. This is particularly occurring when hospitals are involved. and it's very difficult to access the data because of privacy and security issues. So likely, this situation also is fostering like the emergence, the flourishing of new technologies. So for instance, federated in the area of artificial intelligence, federated learning is one solution. So I don't know how familiar you are with this, but it's basically a way of training models without the models seeing the data. How is it possible? So basically, you have like a central model, and you imagine you have a series of hospitals, and you are copying this model inside all those hospitals, and you are training this model inside the hospital. So the data is never leaving the hospital. Everything is done locally. And then what is shared with this centralized model is only the parameters of each of those different hospital-specific models. And those are aggregated in a central model. And this central model is going to be the one that you are finally using for everything, right? So you train the model, but the model never seen the data. Like, you just receive the parameters, okay? So this is one of the ways in which we train models with data that are in hospitals that have sharing constraints, okay? This is one possibility. Another possibility, another technology is synthetic data generation. So this is another way to, you know, preserve privacy of the data. So if you don't want the data of the real patient moving around, you can create synthetic instances of this data, like a synthetic version of it. And so, of course, like, this is going to be like similar to the original data, but different, and above all, is not of anybody. Like, this doesn't belong to anybody. It's a synthetic data. And so this is another way of working with data that is synthetic. It's not the real data, and you can work with that. And related to this, also the technology of digital twins. So this is like a very big umbrella term that entails many, many different technologies. You can have different scales of digital twins. So you can have like simulations at the atomic level, at the cellular level, at tissue level, at organ level, at system level. So each one of those scales, there are specific techniques and methods for it. But the digital twin is basically like, you know, a replica of an aspect of a patient. So again, it's very related to synthetic data, but it's more about simulations, and it's another way of preserving privacy and not, you know, dealing with the real data. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, these are the three that I had noted. And in fact, something important on this federated learning is that it comes together with algorithms for data protection, differential privacy, cryptography, encryption, etc. And for the digital twins, I think also it's very important to add prior knowledge to the AI algorithms that quite often they are agnostic to the context and that can provide it. And relating to this, to the context, and Manuel, I would like you to comment on the explainability, the need for explainability and interpretability. There are people that really, there are different concepts, if would you want to explain the difference, and the importance of the context to understand the results of the AI algorithms and the impact, in particular, because sometimes the impact can have in healthcare effects that are long-term.
Yes, thank you. Explainability means that algorithms that usually are not explainable by themselves could be, show what it's doing or what are the main features that are representing the ways of different features in the system, or which rules are predominant in specific models, right? But that is what is called explainability, which is how we can show in a different manner, more graphical manner, the acting of the result of the algorithm. But it doesn't mean that people will understand this or people could understand how the system is working. It's just an interpretation of what it's doing. And in terms of cognitive relation with this outcome, it could be worth to think about who is the user, who is the reader of this outcome, right? And this, I think you, David, in the presentation talk a lot about cognitive biases and other functional biases, right, that professionals usually have. Sometimes they this comes into discussion the person, the human that is behind the system, right, or yeah, is using the system, that it could be trained on these specific topics, or could be very expert, for example, on medicine or their own topic, but maybe lack some skills on reading information or interpreting, and also knowing when a system is working well or has some errors or maybe some issues that are not expected. Right? And this is one of the main things on trustworthy AI, which is how we can communicate these unexpected behaviors of the systems, right? So it's very complex on how we can consider what we can explain an algorithm and actually what is going on when it's something working on the context of use, right?
But for this, it's key not to have kind of black box models, right? In order to avoid this bias and to have more interaction with the final user towards this kind of active learning or visual analytic interfaces, so that the user can interact with the results of the AI algorithm, right?
I mean, it should be as explainable as better, but the problem is that humans, we are really bad at understanding complex data. So we are usually... maybe if you are a good statistician that you have many years of training, you are very, very good at reading graphics or tables, etc. But many of the professionals don't, because they don't train for this, right? So you can provide a lot of information to persons, but maybe they are not able to understand and spend the time to understand what is going on there. So the system should be designed very on purpose on specific moments of specific decision, and this is when we make a decision as a person, a professional, we need specific information, not everything. We need a system that is designed for that moment, that particular context, mm-hmm. right? And so how we can explain should be very thoughtful.
Yeah, and related to this, I think it's important to also mention the need to involve the communities, no? That maybe can be affected by possible biases of the systems that we are developing. So as Manuel said, no, most of the time, like those explanations that you have from explainable artificial intelligence methods. I mean, if you're a developer, if you're a statistician, maybe you understand them. But if you are my grandma, I mean, probably you are not going to understand much. So what like a solution to this gap in the knowledge is to bring people with different levels of knowledge into the work, like, you know, developing together these co-creation activities that are, you know, very much promoted now also by European projects and other contexts. So of course there is a need to, you know, simplify, you know, and try to find a common knowledge or a common ground in order to convey the message. But it's important. This is not done. I mean, I've never seen it. Like, we organize with Natalie, for instance, you know, like focus groups and communication methodology, so that we can, you know, try to bring the cities and people with a different knowledge closer to our work. But it's definitely like an exception. Maybe, like, you know, I mean, not done. It's something that need to be done more and more for sure, and can help in these situations.
Yeah. Paula, can you comment also on how can we engage all the different stakeholders, and which are the ones that we need to really be sure that they participate in the process of the co-design of the AI algorithm?
Yeah. I think actually that's one of the biggest weaknesses that we have as technology, is that we tend to disregard the participation of other stakeholders and just think that we can do everything, and that's not true. And I think that even raised further with the, as you mentioned also before, right, all the data accumulation that we have and all the rise of big tech, that now there is like a lot of resources to exploit, and we just go ahead without taking into account the stakeholders that are needed for the process. From my opinion, I think few of the stakeholders should be always involved, especially in healthcare. We have data providers, of course, like they are the ones that know all the data journey, and they should always involve because maybe they made some assumptions about the data because they are used to it, and we are just not aware because we didn't talk about it. Also the disease experts, I think this figure is always included in the process, but also they are the ones that will tell us the limitations of the representation of the sample, right? Maybe there are some diseases that do not apply to everybody, so it's good to know, this disease only happens in people from this age range, so now you know that this is a problem definition, right? And the last one that I think is key, and David pointed out, is the patients themselves. Especially, like, not only in the case that you want a solution that will be deployed on them, like a recommender system, something like that, right? Like, you know, you need to know what is the frequency that it will be okay to gather data from them or stuff like that. But also, when you talk about a solution that will be deployed for chronic or complex patients, they are probably the best or the experts of that disease. Like, they are the ones that know everything and all the dependencies and comorbidities that may be related to that. So that's key. And I think that, at least from my experience working at Eurecat, we've done quite some projects on that. And when you include these people from the very beginning and you are working on a solution that will be helpful for them, they are always there. They are eager to that because it's for a good purpose and they will benefit from that if the solution is okay. So you are the first people that is interested in that to be good. So, yeah.
Very good. Before I continue, questions from the audience. Come on, guys. I mean, Aurelio is forcing you to, so. Don't you think this is an interesting debate? Don't you have any questions? Now we can see you. Come on, don't be shy.
I can break the ice if you want.
There is one question.
Hi, I have a question. I heard a lot about what is being worked on, like regarding European comedy and what is being done in Europe and in the States towards all of this, but I don't know if you have any knowledge or if it's relevant. What is being done in Latin America regarding all of these topics, like data, bias, like, because I know that like many of these like biographic situations are, you know, depending on demographics, and like Europe is like having comedies and all that, but do you know or is it relevant, like what is being done like regarding Latin America's communities for this?
I don't specifically know in the health context, but I know there's a lot of movement in terms of gender bias, specifically in data, from all the feminism movements that there are. I've seen a lot of more mostly analyzing data, specifically with violence against women, etc. Right. There's also a kind of support from the International Development Bank. They have the FERLAC program, and they are trying to get into the system. The difference with Europe is that we have this, of course, the European government. It helped us very, let's say, equal manner to all the countries, and in Latin America, each one is going by their own, which is make it difficult. But there are a lot of people on working on this interested. Not you want to.
Yeah, because thank you for the question. I'm from Uruguay, so I am connected with the Inter-American Bank, and right now we coordinate a challenge about gender bias in artificial intelligence, and it was developed in different fields, in medicine, in other more related to gender violence and so on. But obviously, one of the problems, maybe, or is that the debate, the majority of the debate are in English, and of course the paper and all the scientific evidence is published. But there are many people that are working in that, and if you are interested, we can talk later, because there are many things to do. But of course, as Manuel mentioned, the movement of feminism and so on is very powerful in America Latina. So yeah, I think we can contribute, of course, and also the communities, the different communities that we are not of all white European point of view. Okay.
And I really recommend you to check the inaugural lecture we had this year at the School of Engineering at the UPF, that it was given by Emmanuel Leduzet, that he is the founder of the Data Pop Alliance. It's an NGO to work on big data. And they have a lot of projects in Colombia and in other places related to gender violence and the good use of big data. I mean, if you don't find it, just let us know. But there's really nice projects on this side. More questions?
I have it, so I'm gonna. because it was actually, it's not a question, it's a comment related to this. So just to say that it really is, this is like a global issue, no? And it's really important, and we, you know, with your comment and all the things that we've said before, it's very clear that there needs to be more, there's things that need to be done at the European level, but also in the US and South America and Africa and Asia. And there needs to, things need to be done at the level of, you know, the scientists and the people developing this, but also the people who are affected by this. And there's a lot of difficulty in communicating, probably, no? And you just mentioned the language also. I got lots of people interested in this topic who told me, oh, but is it going to be in English? Because I don't understand English. So, no? And also, you know, we're talking about this gender and racial biases, and there are a lot of women here. It's good to see, but we're mostly white people, no? So again, there is, you know, we just need to make this effort of involving everyone, which is difficult because we speak different languages, we have different maybe points of view, but this is also enriching, no? So definitely, I think this is like one main point, no, of this talk, and several of you have mentioned that we have to get everyone at the table, no? So.
Well, we can use AI for translation if needed.
Yeah, we were saying that before, but we said because none of us are native English speakers, probably the translation of the, you know,
exactly.
It's not going to be fantastic.
Yes, one question there.
Okay. Thanks for the talk, first of all. Also, I don't know if this is exactly, I don't know how to phrase it as a question completely. But what I was thinking during the presentations was whether all of these, well, not all of these per se, but these measures feel like half measures. So why chase around every single company and, do you have GDPR? Do you have GDPR? Impossible, completely. So I'm thinking, why not just change the incentives, which I think is the most fundamental part, and, for example, take profit outside the equation. If there was no profit involved, if the companies were not being able to gouge, to, be like vultures on top of the patients in Europe and everywhere, I mean, we are in Europe, so talk about Europe, then there would be no incentive to create these predatory algorithms. So I'm wondering, is there a way to, at least in the works now or in the way that you see it going forward, to really take the real problem out of the equation, because we are, it's like cancer and we are treating the symptoms. The problem is not that, the data, yes, it's biased. It is biased and it's a problem. The problem starts when you download a weather app and it knows when you sleep, where do you connect, where do you go, where do you work. We can talk all day about how this data is being sold, to governments, to companies, to everyone. So, So what is the best way forward? To just try to work around the symptoms and maybe create problems for research? Like you said, you want to do actual research and you can't access the things. And it would be legal and easier to just go to a data broker in the US and buy everything that you need, spend €1,000 and you're done. No ethics committees, no nothing, and you're completely legal. So, again, I don't know if this is a rant or a question, but do you think, since you are more involved than me in this, do you think is there a way to actually move forward? Like with free software, for example. I hope Germany continues the ban on Windows. I don't want to ever see it again. And it's, well, for example, we all have teams involved in our lives, I'm sorry to say. And does it ever work for you? It doesn't work for me. And someone is paying €10,000 per license for this shit.
I have to say that personally, I think that's not the biggest problem. Like, I think there are a lot of scientific and research-based problems that we have not tackled yet. Like in the case of healthcare in particular, we need data to account for bias. And data in the healthcare set, health-related data in the GDPR is considered sensitive information. That means that it's highly protected. And in this case, we find ourselves that, okay, so we need to find the best way to gather data and use it preserving privacy. And at the same time, we need to be able to have that data so to understand bias and equity. So at least in my experience, what I find many cases is that I get data and I don't have demographics, and I don't have any particular identifier that allows me to calculate that bias. So I think that finding the right balance between privacy and having the data to account for bias, it's quite a huge issue in healthcare. And that's a pure scientific method, and also finding the best ways, the security stuff, and like there are a lot of dimensions to that problem. And I'll say, like, also the problem of measuring bias itself, it's also not straightforward, because as he's mentioned before, the definition of bias in healthcare can take a long time. The outcomes in healthcare can take a long time to cure. So it may be that you have a system that is very small biased, but then over a long period of time, it will have a huge bias. And then you need to have all this data through all this time to be able to account for the total bias. Like, if you have a data sample now and a data sample at a time point before, it's not enough to have a complete picture of whatever is happening. And that's about the definition of bias itself. So I think there are a lot of things to do, a part of the capitalism world we live in. I don't know if the rest of you want to.
Yes, exactly. I was thinking about capitalism as well. This is very difficult. I mean, like, specifically you said, not like taking out the profit from the equation. Like, how do you do that? Like, it's not easy, because we have to acknowledge that we live in the society in which we live. And historically, like, we reached this point, and so now it's, we are fostering this data revolution, but, I think the solution is, like, try to find a solution that can be appealing for the industry, but at the same time, for a commercial point of view, let's say, but at the same time also respectful of the human rights and all the other problems. For instance, like the new European data space that is going to be created, they are going to incentivize the industry to put their data there, so that they have more visibility, so that they like their data can be like maybe used in European projects, or maybe like, and so they can say, ah, look, this is like I'm contributing to the good of the European community, no? So this is the type of incentive. So no money involved, just visibility, but it's a way also to access even more data, right, in the context of Europe. So those are all ideas, or maybe like the data altruism that we were talking before. This is coming directly from the citizen, so it's something really bottom up, as he was saying before. So there are, you know, hints, suggestions, ideas that circulates, but definitely we have to find more solutions going into this direction. But it's not easy at all.
Mm-hmm. I'm the moderator. So let me copy a question that I heard in a panel a couple of weeks ago. And I need to tell you, the answers in that committee were full of bullshit. And it was how the members of that panel saw hospitals and healthcare in relation with AI, etc., in 2030. In relation to what we have been discussing until now on AI, the application of AI, the impact on healthcare, biases, etc. That's a tough one. That's a tough one. It's in 8 years. How do you see it? It can be wrong, exactly. Totally wrong. It's going to be totally wrong.
I'm not sure I get the question. So in 8 years, they are going to find, they are going to actually actuate, no?
How do you foresee the use of AI in hospitals in 2030?
Yeah, okay. So I've been involved recently in the reduction of an assessment of the system for basically clinical decision support. So algorithms that are used in Spain. This is for Spain. That are used in the health system, no? Like artificial intelligence that is used in the health system nowadays to help doctors take decisions, and this is like. Well, it's a document that is redacted by AQUAS and so the regulatory agency, and we have to go through a systematic review and all these kind of things. Well, the result is that there are very few. Like, I mean, it's not really used. So we are talking about, you know, a lot of applications in the health system and the danger of this. But the reality is that nowadays, there are not many, and in Spain even less. If we look worldwide, the hospitals that are really using technology so advanced in the real clinical practice, they are not that much, which is a good thing. So especially like refer to this horizon of 2030, because we see that there are a lot of issues. So if we have this, like, let's say, cautious attitude towards technology in the health system, this is definitely a good thing. One example of something that they tried to uptake in the clinical practice, and it was like a disastrous experience, is Watson Health. So Watson Health is an example of a technology that it was like, I mean, super promoted a lot, and they spent years in trying to make these things work for real in the clinical practice in the Sloan Kettering Hospital in New York. And it was like a total failure, because it was not giving, like, you know, it was giving answers that like a medical student can give to you, not nothing new. So yeah, there is this difficulty. Also, Paola was mentioning, like, we are not there yet in terms of the technology. So yes, 2030, difficult, but yes, like step by step.
But maybe I prevent you saying don't say bullshit. But in the other table, it was like, everyone will have our own digital twin, and we'll have preventive medicine, and everything will be automatic AI.
Not 2030. I would say. Consider that the most advanced technologies, so artificial intelligence nowadays, that has a real potential in this are images. So everything related to image, medical image processing, and these kind of things, and natural language processing. This is also very advanced, but those are two very, like, you know, two very specific domains, which are very useful in the health, but it's not the digital, you know, like, it's
no.
Very,
but for this, I think it's important that people understand what is the clinical workflow in the hospital, and there are tasks that are kind of low risk, like this helping AI to reconstruct signals, images, to detect objects. If then there is going to be quality control by a clinician, it's okay. Is when you move this AI towards clinical decisions that can have really a direct impact to the patient, is where this is not happening. Mm. But you were mentioning before this federated learning, that we'll see what it happens with this, right? Because this means that you need to have the infrastructure in the hospital, and you need to have a mini BSc In Mare Nostrum, in every hospital, data needs to be collected in the same way in every hospital, needs to be curated in the same way. Is this happening in the next 100 years?
Yes, well, not in Spain. Yes, of course. This is also the difficulty of this, and these standards. All this is related to the standards that are used by the different hospital, the formats. This is something very important. There is also work into this direction. But this is why I'm saying this horizon 2030 is very optimistic, because it's definitely not reliable, because many things must change before, in terms of, you know, these standards, for instance, and the technology, how they advance, and all the risks that those technology brings forward. So yeah, many things, too many things for having this like concretely up and running by 2030. Yeah.
One of the key messages that hospitals need to change. And to change a hospital, it's something that takes a lot of time, generational changes, etc. So this is not going to happen. Let me finish, and we need to go towards the end. I was finding, according to Richard Stallman again, for him, the fundamental rights, and to him, these are related to human rights, the four essential freedoms, and that are quite important to ensure transparency of algorithms, including AI. One is the freedom to run the program as you wish for any purpose. Second, the freedom to study how the program works and change it so it does your computing as you wish. The freedom to redistribute copies so you can help others. And the freedom to distribute copies of your modified versions to others. So for him, these are the four fundamental essential freedoms for free software, that if we want to promote less bias in the AI algorithms, I think these are not too bad principles to follow. But then we need to see, and again, libre, no gratis, that there is a commercial side on this, and that startup companies, because big tech corporates, well, they can manage to deal with whatever regulation, whatever problem. But how this is affecting and making more difficult for technology transfer, for going from research to having a product. If it's already almost a miracle to get a product from research directly, we're imposing more and more things. Like I think before it was said, before going to a product, it needs to be fair and fully tested and validated. Well, this is going to be even more difficult for startups to get this, right? And the last comment from my side is how important this is for medical students and for engineering students. These are dilemmas that you are going to see in your life. And during your education, this type of debates are critical. How important are ethics on the work that you are doing and how your algorithms are going to be used later? This morning we had a talk with Nikos Kastanos. He's an ambassador of the Hippocratic movement. And we are getting and having initiatives with them in order to increase the awareness for biomedical engineers or any engineer on the ethical principles of what you are doing. Because it's not only clinicians. Whatever you are going to do is going to have an impact on patients if you do good work. So this is key, and we need to work together to develop these algorithms without any type of bias. So thank you very much.
Okay, so let me. So thank you very much, Oscar, Paula, Davide, and Manuel, and those participating in the debate. We're going to move to the second one, which is going to be moderated by Marusha, who already welcomed us in this event. So Marusha She has a PhD in biology at Cambridge University, but later moved to the to work on communication and the impact of research activities. Currently, no, she's working at the Biomedical Research Park, PRBB, here in Barcelona, where she's, among many things, coordinating to working groups that involve all the institutions in the park, the six institutions. On the one hand, the one on diversity and inclusion, and on the other hand, of research integrity. So she will be moderating the talk, so you can come here. Do you want me to introduce, or you? Okay, so Marusa will introduce our three experts and Ojitija. So thank you very much, all.
Okay, thanks, Aurelio. And thank you very much for, well, thank you very much for the speakers of the first table and Oscar for very interesting discussions. And now we're going to start the second table, which we're again trying to discuss about how to advance in these issues, maybe from a more social perspective rather than some technological. But, you know, again, as Oscar said before, I'll start asking questions to the speakers, but anyone can answer anything. And if anyone wants to ask, and hopefully later we can continue and you can ask questions to the speakers from the first table also, so we amplify the discussion. So let me introduce the people in this second table. So we have Paula Petrone there in red. So Paula is an associate research professor at IS Global, the Institute for Global Health, also at the PRBB. She leads the biomedical data science team, focused on diagnosing chronic and infectious diseases using computer vision and advanced machine learning techniques. So again, very relevant. She graduated in physics in Argentina and then did a PhD in biophysics at Stanford. And she's been a biomedical data scientist in the life science and also private sector, startup sector, for more than 10 years in areas such as drug discovery, health informatics, and image analysis. And also, apart from her research at IS Global, she's also a digital health consultant, mentor, and activist on ethics, artificial intelligence, and diversity in STEM careers. And she very recently organized Women in Data Science in Biomedicine conference at the PRBB before the summer, was it? Very successful one also. So thanks for being here. We have also Natalie Bouslon, who was already here with us at the beginning, who's a postdoctoral researcher and also the Equity, Diversity and Inclusion Officer at the Barcelona Supercomputing Center. And she did a degree in social research and a PhD in sociology at the University of Barcelona. So as I said before, we have like different backgrounds to add to the table. She was visiting researcher at Stanford University and Columbia University, and her research focuses on social and ethical aspects of artificial intelligence, and in particular, sex and gender and diversity analysis. So hopefully we'll be hearing from that also. And as she mentioned before, I don't know if you mentioned that, but she is a member of the Organization for Women in Science for the Developing World, and also involved with the Inter-American Development Bank. Yeah. So thank you very much. Then we have Akinola Akinbote, who's a PhD candidate at the EMBL, the European Molecular Laboratory, and Heidelberg University. He's doing his research in the EMBL Barcelona, also in the PRBB, where he's developing vascularized in vitro 3D tissues to model cardiovascular physiology and pathology. So in other words, he's trying to understand heart disease using stem cells and tissue engineering. So he's the most biomedical part. And he's also our youngest panelist. He graduated a couple of years ago from the university in Cleveland in the US. And before starting his PhD here, he's also worked in the medical devices industry. So he brings this experience with him, as well as his interest in in diversifying scientific education by training, representing, and involving underrepresented voices in STEM. So thank you, the three of you, and also Oyedilla, who's joining the table also virtually. So actually, I wanted to start with a question to Oyedilla that I thought about when we were discussing on the listening to the first table. So obviously, there was a discussion about the problems of getting data, no, because of the GDPR, and that involves all kind of data from everyone. But going to the lack of diversity in the data, I also wanted to, well, I wanted to ask you your view about also the difficulty beyond these regulations, difficulty of getting data from minority communities that perhaps historically have been, you know, I'm talking about the biomedical field, abused, no, in biomedical research from many years, and how perhaps they have this mistrust, no, with science. So how can we, you know, regulations apart, how can we get that trust to get this data to begin with, to get them to participate in research projects?
Yeah, as you said, Marusha, there's a complete mistrust, not only in the biomedical field, but in all kinds of fields that are including research, because we have already experienced as people of color that we have been being part of research generously in a way that researchers were collecting information from us, but after the information of the collection of that data, we didn't have any other we didn't have many more news from the researchers about which were the findings or which were the conclusions that they took with all this data, and that leads in the end to a mistrust, to a way or a complete denial of having or organizing something with researchers or trying to collaborate with them, because we see that our visions or the many times also the explanations, the stories that we provide in the end, probably they are used, but in a way that we don't think they are valuable for us, because in the end, research should be also valuable for everyone. And especially when you are being part of it, or even you are being like they are, you are being in the center of that research, you should be in a certain way also informed about the kind of outcomes that the researchers had, and in order to provide or to bring them back, because it's something that it will take lots of efforts, because let's say that the relationship is already broken and that we should try to connect them again. So maybe sometimes I'm thinking also about, because this is something that is happening in many other fields, there should be like a person who should be in the center, who should try to bring, like who should try to do some kind of mediation between researchers and the communities that understands both sides of the process. For example, a person who has already experienced as a researcher, but for example, is also part of the communities that we are trying to study. It could be something that it's great in order to bring those fields or those two ways of working that they want to develop in the end, something together, in order to make sure that all the needs from both sides are fulfilled. Because many times when we are asking, for example, certain communities to work with, for example, at the biomedical field, probably they are asking them to do things in order that in a free way. But many times these communities already have many other issues that they are trying to accomplish or that they are trying to overcome. So maybe there should be also a way in which these people, these communities, or these people who are volunteering themselves in order to provide this information can also feel like they can receive a certain kind of compensation. It should be, for example, in terms of money, or simply just by asking, hey, we want to do a research with you. What kind of things you need in order to make to make sure that you feel comfortable to work with us. Do you want us to remove your name? Do you want us to not, collaborate with more people that you think it is relevant for this research? In the end, it's more about having a dialogue between researchers and communities to have them work together. And for sure, if we can provide a person that is in the middle of researchers and communities, that makes it easier.
Yes, Natalie.
I want to just add one of the things that we are start to do in the BSE and also as a sociologist. I think more in the middle, this is why we need multidisciplinary teams working together, because one of the role of the sociologist is research societies and try to connect, to have this link. So I just want to express that what we are doing, and in, for example, in one research that we developed for the transgender, and it was to know about bias in medicine. Well, this is the main problem that we have in science, that we sometimes we take the information and we don't give big feedback or any solution later to the communities. So one of the first thing is to connect with directly with the social movement, the social organization, and try to give a relationship first and show that this is not just to take the information and later when we develop the technology to test if it's okay or no or whatever. Is to develop something with a social impact that could improve the quality of life. So the communicative methodology, that is one of the methodology that is used apply in social scientists, have different principles that we apply when we are working with the people. The first one that we sometimes in academia we don't apply that is to talk in an equal level. Because sometimes when we are working with users, we are all time talking like we are the experts and we know everything, and our knowledge is more valuable that for the people that they are really have the problems. So this is one of the first things that we need to learn. And when we start this project with Davide and another colleague from the association Prisma, that is the LGTB in Spain, we start to connect with them and we say, okay, we want to have the data. We want to start in the beginning with a group to ask, for example, in the first level, which type of question and if the survey is okay for them, if they agree that this is the good way to ask that, because neither I and Davide know more than the problem of them. So we need to introduce not just the people and the diversity in our research, we need to participate and co-work with together. Because all the people, and what is the principle of this methodology is to think that everyone have a valuable knowledge, no? We know we are experts in some things, but they are expert in other things. So I think it's important to recover this trust is to have this principle as we need them and they need us. So it's an important thing. Okay, so to work with the social movement also to participate in all the level, not in the last one or the first level, and also we plan to share the draft of paper with them, so on. And later, of course, if there are a social impact of our report and so on, because the European Commission are asking right now about that. So sorry, I don't want to interrupt, but I think it is one of the most important things for AI and for all the research, you know, to start mm-hmm. to work together in an equal level.
Yeah, no, definitely. I think exactly beyond AI, no, any type of research, to have also this bi-directional communication and the co-creation that we were mentioning before, no? But I want to touch on a figure that Oyedija mentioned, this mediator, like someone who is a researcher, but is also from one of the communities affected, no? And in that sense, I wanted to ask Paula, no, about this, because we talk about the diversity in the data, but then another cause of these biases in technology is that the people who develop these technologies are, you know, not very diverse, no? So they are mostly white men. There's lots of women nowadays starting, no? Also, there's lots of students that are female, and this is great, but still very low, the proportion of female in the STEM sciences, and especially like in, I don't know, engineering or physics or things like that, no? So why is that, and how can institutions or companies also, the level of companies, increase the workforce, the female workforce, and other minorities? Females are not minority, but you know what I mean.
For that question, I think it's a difficult question and has a complex answer too. I'm gonna give my opinion, which is from the research, we know that there is no a dependence of intelligence or performance on sex and gender. So that's a fact, right? So why are less women in STEM? Is that we cannot, we are not interested? It's not that we are not smart. So I think one of the main problems is the way that we are raised since we are kids. Men are raised to be brave, and women, we are raised to be perfect. And that's a huge difference, because we are not trained to make mistakes. We are not trained to be dirty. We are not trained to be impolite or even break the rules. So if you are thinking of careers that are stereotypically difficult, right? Like you have to imagine the stereotype of a scientist, right? Albert Einstein. So then you think, like, as a woman, I wasn't trained to just go for it and make a lot of mistakes. I'm trained to be perfect. So if I go there, I'm going to make a lot of mistakes. I'm going to fail. So it's better that I go to other careers where the benchmark is less clear. And it doesn't mean that social sciences doesn't need like really smart people. They do. But the benchmark of what is perfect or right or wrong is different to the STEM sciences. Their mistakes are much more evident. So it's possible that girls are not raised or stimulated to just be brave enough to say, okay, I'm going to fail. I'm going to find a lot of mistakes in my code, right? So then I give up. It's not about you. So people, when you have a mistake, it's difficult, or it's because that's the way that you code. You just make mistakes. It's not about you. It's about the way that the STEM science work and how you work when you are a scientist. You just make mistakes. That's how you learn. So I think confidence is one part. The other one is the stereotypes. You imagine the STEM scientist is like Sheldon, right? Like you see the guy that cannot communicate, is always perfect, always bright. But if we raised our girls to think about how important it is to be a scientist and how much you can help, how much you can communicate with others, and these are the things that you were saying before, like reaching out to groups, finding, answering questions, moving the field forward, then maybe there will be more girls. Because it's about communicating, about bonding, about solving problems. And then maybe we will be more engaged, right? And maybe then I think when we think about these two topics, then we also find the topic about the role models. You don't want to go to, I mean, most people here, maybe many people will be in the STEM field, and you go to class and it's mostly men. So then, or non-diverse, right? So then you are less likely to be in that environment. And when you are, and then when you're thinking about applying to a job and you go to an interview, and it has happened to me. I was interviewed in a group by 10 men. And that's very scary, especially when you are starting your career. I was in New York, it was in a company where everybody wearing suits, and I was there right out of my PhD, and it was very scary. I felt like I had to be a man to be able to be, you know, I failed, but I cannot say I failed because it was a woman. One will never know, but it was very weird to be in that position. So I think it's a problem of confidence from women, and I think it's mostly around confidence stereotypes and role models.
Mm-hmm. Yep, totally agree. I don't know if Akinola, you want to say also something.
She made very salient points. So kind of
agree with everything.
Yeah. But is it about, like, so then I was also thinking about how we women feel, but when you're a minority, not a woman, like, can you ask about other types of diversity? Because
I don't know if you can hear me. So it's, I feel like for many people, and this is also documented in some sort in sociology, where there's the concept of double consciousness. So as a black person or minority in a space, you have to switch. And that switching means that you coming as your full self into that space is not accepted. You being a woman coming in might not be fully accepted. You being a person of an underrepresented minority might not be accepted. And this ties down to what stereotypes are. As a scientist, okay, you can't ask these questions. You can bring in politics into this space. And when I mean politics, I mean like, oh, like why, if in us, like at our institute, for instance, we're talking about having menstrual products in toilets. It doesn't affect me, but someone could see that as a social political stance as opposed to something that's an essential thing. And now, like most people that designed the space are like, it's just a bathroom. Why should we include menstrual products in the bathroom? Because it doesn't affect me. And so if you go into that space, looking at it from like a biological sex perspective, I wouldn't feel welcome. I wouldn't feel like this is a space for me. And therefore, I'm more likely to just leave that unwelcoming environment and pursue something else that gives me joy and makes me more welcome. And I think that's something that you can see it in women in STEM. You could see it in other minorities in STEM. And that's something we should address, making that space a place where we can be our full selves and can then be represented there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think what you mentioned of it doesn't affect me, yeah, it kind of summarizes everything. It summarizes, you know, all these biases that we're talking about. You know, it's not the only problem, but one problem is, well, and not as, I think, I can't remember who was saying, I think it was Oyedilla. It's not that whoever is developing this code thinks, oh, you know, I don't care about these other people. It's they don't think about these other people, no?
To that, maybe I want to quote a beautiful, which says, privilege is invisible to those who have it. Mm-hmm. So if you are enjoying it, you just don't see, and I think what this is one of the reasons you organize this panel, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, oh, definitely. So, yeah, I thought Oyedilla wanted to say something. If anyone wants to say something, or if anyone wants to ask any question now, can we have the lights on again to put pressure? There's one question here and one question there. Ah, she wanted to say something also. Okay, so Oyedilla, yes, you wanna?
Sorry, I lowered my hand before answering. The thing is that you were asking specifically how we can approach or how we can make sure that there's more diversity or more people from minorities inside of the STEM field. And something that it's very important to ask is how we are writing the job descriptions, for example, or the requirements, or where are we publishing it, and how we are making sure that those offers are also available for people who are not in our networks, because we are always trying to advertise this kind of works, research, and many applications in our own networks that look like us. So if we are not trying to make the effort to advertise this kind of opportunities, because in the end they are opportunities for many people who are from underrepresented backgrounds to have the option to be part of it, we are making a mistake. And also many times, another thing that we can ask is to how we can make that science and technology can be more approachable to those communities, because it's something that it doesn't happen. And I think that one thing that we could do is to just to collaborate with civil society organizations on this, because there's many people who are really willing to be like you and like us in the end to work in things in which we can have a better future for many other people, but that they don't have this opportunity because it is not available for them. The information is not available, and we have to make it also accessible for everyone.
I just want to tell a story, which is quite embarrassing. I was at the position to recruit a data science team, and I had money for 10 people. So I interviewed men and women, and the result was that the candidates, the accepted people, were 10 men. And being a feminist, this was quite embarrassing, and I didn't feel good about it, but I couldn't explain why. And going to Ojida's comment, a friend of mine said, can you please give me your job post? So I gave her the job post, and when she read it, she's like, that's why you got all men. And the job post said, like, high achievers, high performance, excellent skills at computer, requisites, Python, C++, 10 years experience, 5 of these, master in this. And she's like, no women will apply to this. And I say, why? I mean, I want good people in my team. And she's like, that's not what appeals to women. Because of the same topic about confidence, women only apply if they fulfill 100% of the requisites. Whereas men, this is a fact known, apply if they achieve 60% of the job requisites. And I think that's okay, because no employee will be perfect for a job. Another time, I had another PhD student applying for the job. In that same recruitment, she had a Nature paper, and she had been out of the job working with her dad for 1 year. And she told me, Paula, I'm not capable. I don't know if I'm going to be able to code again because I haven't coded for 1 year. She had a PhD and a Nature paper, and I could not hire her because she was telling me that she was not suitable for the job. So just to say that when we write a job position, this is very important that we write nurturing personality, nurturing opportunities to learn, very nice environment, work-life balance, and we can put women encouraged to apply, or women and all diversities, minorities are encouraged to apply. So that was maybe what I learned from that experience, and I think Natalie also has.
No, I totally agree. Actually, it's one of the politics that we need to follow in all the companies. I think one of, as you mentioned, no, there are many reasons why right now the academia in general is... is one of the main things is the power, no? For me, the power is that where is the right now the money is in technology. So this is another point because yes, there are stereotypes and we have group that are underrepresented, but also we live in a society that right now is changing, but it's an androcentric, it's a model where the men, white men, young, is the center, no? Okay, so it's the structure follow the money, and as you we know, right now the new technology is consent, have the center of everything. So we need to try to be conscious exactly of the bias that we have in the society. And when we are applying for a job, we need to be conscious, as you say, that the scientific evidence show that women have less security to apply than men because, as we know, the power it was immense, or they are more confident. Is the true? Is the if we check this the story? Actually, there are countries that right now women that haven't got human rights. No, so this is not just like a historical bias. There's a problem that today we have. So we need to be conscious of that. That we need to be conscious that, as you say, the privileged people is very easy to decide what career do want to follow. And there are other that, for example, in my country or another country, that is born in a place that there are not medical schools. So if they want to be doctors, they need to move to another city, and they need to pay for that, and for the rent and the student. So
why we have many places that, for example, in my country, that there are only teachers or, I don't know, or public job, because this is the only option that they have. So if you are from the poor sector in your society, you don't have all the option to study artificial intelligence and go to Stanford and so on. So this is why we need to apply politics, quotas, and so on. In Brazil, they apply quotas to bring more people, black people in the society, in the university, sorry. So this is why we need to apply all these conscious actions, and of course in human resources. Right now, for example, we are working in the BSc to check the job offer. They are a great tool that called gender decoder. When you put, you can copy paste your job offer, and automatically you can check the vocabulary in English, at least as it's developed, but that word that are more related with female profile, male profile, and to try to say, as Paula mentioned, to add a specific sentence, like we encourage underrepresented group, women, and we value the diversity, no? And why? Because science is better when we have diverse point. Of course, it's a human right introduced for the population in academia, but also if you don't matter that, it's for the quality of your research. There are scientific evidence that show the experiment that puts people that are similar and have similar profile, similar age, they're from the same country, and people that are diverse from different background age, and you will have more innovative ideas. So this is, there are more, yes, a lot of samples, no?
No, most definitely. And I think with the topic we're discussing today, that would decrease the biases a lot if you have, you know, people from different communities or you know, people differently affected, they will bring that knowledge, no, to it. I think you wanted to say something, Agnoli? Ah, okay. So we had a question.
To bring an issue first, to understand if it is a problem, and second, if it is a problem, then how can we contribute to address it? So I think we are in a transition where we have institutions that have very strong diversity and inclusion mandates, but also they have very little diversity in their staff, particularly in their senior staff. And I think in this context, what's happening is that there is people who are underrepresented are members of the staff, particularly they are early stage career people, and they are being overburdened with diversity and inclusion actions. They are the people who are sent to speak to high schools and to speak to meeting and to somehow show two things. One that is like just form, and the other that is more like function, right? So to show that the institution cares about diversity, but also to attract new people to study STEM or new people to join the institution and so on. So I wonder, first, if this is a problem that we are overburdening people from underrepresented groups, particularly early stage career people, with diversity and inclusion efforts. And second, what can more senior people or more privileged people do to contribute to reduce this burden, if that is a reality?
I can respond. So I think, since like 2013, I've been involved in diversity efforts, even though my primary training is in engineering, right? So yes, many underrepresented minorities are overburdened. What can be done about it? The same way we hire professionals to take care of human resources, the same way we hire professionals to take care of different aspects of our businesses, of the school, hire people that study these things and actually have the job, and not the person you hire to do something else. Like, if I'm hired to work as a data scientist, let me work as a data scientist. If I choose to participate in this, that's fine. It should not be the expectation. If I'm like, and I think that's that way you reduce the burden on like the already underrepresented minorities, and you also show that your company or your institution is serious about these efforts they say that they actually care about, because you put money where your mouth is, and if you don't do that, it shows that you're not serious. I have this conversation with my boss, my PI, and I tell her that if I don't see that resources are being allocated towards this, I'm not going to participate in this, because this is all front-facing. This is all to make the institution look good, but they're not going to care about me when I'm trying to juggle my curriculum as a PhD student and also a diversity officer. So I think that's, I don't know if that answers your question.
Yeah, I totally agree. Actually, the other day we were, because the majority of the Barcelona institution research center are part of SOMA, that is Vero Ochoa, and we, the other day we have a meeting and we discuss about the recognition of to be part of the equity committee and to work about diversity and gender. So it's related to one of the things that I want to mention, that you need to consider this type of activity as like give a point, a score to that, for like a paper, you know, because this in this sense you need to the people or the certification, like for example, if you apply a Juan de la Sierva, you know, FPU, different fellowship that consider your participation in this type of activity, because it's time. And the problem is, I always say that we are like take time of the people that have more problems to get more recognition paper and so on. So this is one of the thing that we need to check, the how the agency, the funding agency or that support fellowship and so on and give the money for the project, give a score to all this type of activity, the fair one, to give the recognition. Also, if you are publishing a paper, the editors, the journals, if they consider also this type of, if they pay attention to the diversity of the team who are in the paper, the different background and so on. And yes, this is, and why you say that the majority of the people are in the first step. Yes, this is why the power is in the, it's also happened with women. We know that we need to introduce women, but it's not just the participation. We need leader women and leader people that later take decision, like in the institution. Because if not, it will be just number, to increase the number and not to change the culture of the society and also in the research. No? Because if you just have diversity in your group, but they are all PhD students, and later the PIs and senior researchers are the same ideas and so on, you will be have the same results. So, yeah.
I guess everything's linked because... I mean, maybe it's a generational thing, and you know, it will eventually, you know, improve, hopefully. But also, if the few people that are from minorities are burdened with these extra things, then they're not going to reach those stages, no? So it's all related. You want?
I just want to make a small comment that yes, this is a responsibility of our generation to bridge the gap, so that there is no gap in the next generation. I'm with you. Also, agree that we have to give prize to reward the people that are doing this work. But I think there is nothing more convincing than when people that are not from the minority, like the privileged people, speak on behalf of the inequality, of the equality. And it's the case of the previous panel, right? Where you see there is nothing better than there is men speaking about how unequal this society is. So maybe our goal of the people that are minorities that are overburdened is to go recruit the privileged, and convince them, bring them to talks so that there is a change. We organize women in data science, and most of the people in the audience were women. There were men. There were more men than last year. Thinking we should maybe change the title. Unfortunately, it's like a franchise. But this is a problem with women in or minority in whatever stuff. But
yeah, and can I say, in this event, we are majority of women. There's a lot of, I mean, it's quite equal. I think from, you know, the registration data, it was, can't remember if it was maybe 70% or 60% women and 40% men, something like that. Yeah. which is very good, but I think there's many more men in this field than women.
Exactly.
So there should be more men than women in this event if we think that this is the target, no? And I think I like your sentence you said before that privilege is invisible to those who have it, and I think it's also uncomfortable. And I think this is, I speak as a, on the one side, privileged person, no, as a white person, and I think it is true. And this is a work we all have to do. No? Another question? Yeah, thank you.
Hello. Thank you for the panel. It's been amazing. I have a question that it's maybe more related to the previous table, but it is kind of general, so if you don't mind. Because I have a feeling that, let's say, because it is more an idea than a question, so let's see if I can formulate it. Because so far we've seen that work is being done when the decision of using an AI system has been taken, like we have this AI system that needs to solve a task. So we find these biases, so let's try to detect them, let's try to mitigate them, and work is being done with that. And by the other hand, we have the problem of gathering data that we need to do it in a diverse way, in an ethical way, and so on. But yeah, I have the feeling that all these scenarios are like start when the decision of using an AI system has been taken. So I'm wondering if maybe we are missing an important discussion that should be taking place like previously, like wondering if we need to use an AI system to solve the task at hand. And maybe this discussion should be not technological at all. It should be more like philosophical or, I don't know, or political, because we would need to take it into account, like the power dynamics in all this technological mess. Maybe we are being counterproductive, like proposing to solve a task by using an AI system. I don't know. This is the idea. Maybe the question would be if you are aware if about whether this discussion is taking place, if we are like thinking about this, or we are just like, yeah, let's. Invent a model to solve this task, and if we find biases, we will solve them.
So would the question be like, before doing something, should we ask, is this AI system going to improve or is it going to make it worse?
Kind of, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. So I do think that whoever's undergoing training needs to not just focus on the technique they're learning, but the impact of their work right from early on. And I was fortunate to be able to take some other classes that were non-science that made me question why I'm going into biomedicine. But I've realized that that's not the case for everyone, to be able to ask those questions, because if you are beginning to consider the impact of your work early on, that will be tailored into how you ask your research questions, right? So like in our lab, we use explore questions on like biological sex differences in tissue engineering. Many people have published that they can make a heart on a chip, they can make a lung on a chip, but how many people are questioning the roles of hormones in that, for instance? How many people actually are questioning the fact that when we develop drugs, usually it's common practice to remove female mice from the experiments because they complicate the research. But if you're trained early on to begin to question these things, and I think if it's on a national or global level, people begin to think about this before they incorporate that into their whatever technology, be it AI, be it medicine development, be it tissue engineering. Like, it's something that I think, in my opinion, should be taught as early as like the last few years of high school, going into whatever you want to do. I think that would be helpful so that we can avoid trying to like put Band-Aids on an already broken system. So that's my... Mm-hmm. Yeah,
thank you. So starting early and the importance of education is basic.
I think it's almost unavoidable that we will look at nature and we will make models. We've done that since we came out of the cave, maybe, right? So many times you hear about AI, but sometimes it's a regression or some statistical model. Mm-hmm. There's so much smoke, like I tell you, from the industry and the academia, there is a lot of smoke. Mm-hmm. So what we do is a model that predicts the future, thinks about if it will rain or not rain. So I think the issue is not whether we use and we develop an algorithm or not, it's how we do with what we do with the results and how that it will impact. And I think today, Ojidia mentioned about the risk and the regulations of what will be done with that algorithm, because we cannot impede or prevent people from modeling or from thinking, oh, there is a pattern here. This we all do all the time, with math or without math. It's almost a human activity. But what we do with an algorithm is a responsibility of all to say, okay, is that fair or not? So I love your question. Eh? I was thinking, but I don't think we will prevent people and say, hey, should we develop AI or not? Many times in medicine, AI is really, really useful. It's really useful because a doctor has like 5 minutes for a patient. And it would be great if an algorithm says, hey, you should spend 10 minutes with this patient because it's a more difficult case than you think.
Mm-hmm. I think, I think Ojidia wanted to say something, but if you want to reply to her, Akinola, quickly.
Briefly, I think while we cannot avoid the development of technology, we also have to consider like how the technology is being developed. And I think that's where your question is coming from. Because sometimes I have this conversation with my doctor and I'm like, so you say that there's a race-based correction, but have you read the paper where the race-based correction comes from? And most of those cases, I can talk as a black person, so I was originally born in Nigeria. It's based off a small population in the US. And this research was done before the whole Human Genome Project, before we started understanding about genetic diversity, even within racial groups. So they already have algorithms that determine like my glomerular filtration rate, so how well my kidney functions, and then, or how well my heart functions. And if I'm black, I get a lower score than a white person. It's standard, and it's backed up by literature. But it's the problem is not just that, okay, let's think about the results. It's back to how we are designing. Why are we designing it this way? Why do we think that this is how to address the question? And I think you've made valid points before saying, if we don't have the people designing this, representative of the end users, thinking about these other questions, like we are going to go back to the same point. No matter what tool we use, it's or we develop, if it's from sharpening a stone to make a knife, to creating the next global ruler AI, it's gonna be the same if we don't address it from the get-go. Yeah, sorry, I hope I didn't.
No, fantastic. So let's give the opportunity to Ojidia to you have your hand raised or is it?
Yep. Well, the thing is that thinking that technology will answer all our questions is something that is wrong, because before we. Actually, talking about technology, technology has been always with us, like during all the history. But now it has a form in which we call it AI, or we call it algorithm, or we call it a system. Something that we don't understand really what it is, but it exists. It seems like it seems like a god. It's just like you believe in it, and then everything has to be everything that you design has to have AI because. Somebody said that it's a trend, and if you're not doing this, it's not trendy, it's not cool, it's not something that you're looking into the future. But at the same time, I think that we should also ask ourselves if certain kind of systems should be banned completely. Because if this is something that we never, or in many discussions, they are not addressing this. Because sometimes if we completely ban certain applications of AI, we are already making sure that certain communities are not going to be they are not going to be affected by certain things that probably it's just deciding if you live or you die, because this is something that is happening. An AI tool right now, it is a more powerful instrument than a gun, because by the decisions that already the AI system is making. People are completely desperate sometimes because you can even have a second opinion of what an AI system is giving you. And this is making more complicated the things. And And for example, one of the things that at the EU level we are doing is to ask for banning certain kind of uses of AI. And this is something that it's feasible to ask, and it's also reasonable to do it. But of course, we will see if in the end, for example, at the EU level, it is something that is going to have a good answer from the parliament or from the governments, because in the end there is a moment where I think that we are asking our politicians to do something about it, but realizing that our politicians don't have any question or answer about it. They don't know about what is happening at the moment at laboratories or at research projects. They don't have any idea. And this information that they have, if they have any of it, they receive it from big technological companies. So in the end, those who are just drafting the agenda are big tech, are the big tech and not the governments. And in the end, we see that big tech companies are working more as governments, as national governments, more than their own governments. And this is something that we have to take also into account, because in the end, the people who are regulating it are not politicians. They are just people who are working on research, they have already interests in that their systems just go ahead, that they continue, that they can continue growing, and that in the end they have the resources, the funding in order to continue with the development. But if we can try to advocate to ban certain systems, it is the way in which we know that certain technologies are not going to be applied for any of us, and to make sure that this is not going to hurt anyone.
I was going to say that's a controversial idea, not to completely ban some uses. So can you tell us some examples of some of these uses that you think should be banned? Or,
for example, they could be completely banned, those that you know already that they are not going to work on everyone. I cannot give an exact example on health, but for example, one of the things that we are asking, for example, is to ban any kind of application, for example, of biometrical data at borders, for example, because in the end, we don't know exactly why they are using this kind of information from people who are trying to enter in our European borders, for example. But this is something that, in the end, when we are talking about biometrical data, it is being applied in many other kind of fields. And this is one of the applications that we are really fighting for in order to avoid that even at a private practice or a public practice, it can be developed and continue being implemented in our cities, in our work, and in our society in the end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I just want to add some comment there. I totally agree that right now with technology, we are amplifying all the problems, but it's not just artificial intelligence. We have all this problem in medical data since centuries. The preclinical trial, the mouse are majority male mouse. And this is why, as David explained, in the DB gap and all the genetical data, we haven't got the variable sex and neither the race and age. Sometimes they neither take into account. So I think right now is a good moment, because the artificial intelligence allowed to amplify this problem and to bring together all the people to think the solution, okay? This is the moment. And the young people that are developed this technology have right now the power. But for me, I recently visited Stanford and talked with people of there, what they are doing, and I was surprised for one activity that they are start to develop in Harvard and right now in Stanford. Because David and I, and the BSE, another center, start to have courses specifically in PhD programs regarding sex, gender, intersectional design to this discussion in a curriculum. But the good thing that Harvard started doing, and Stanford also, and I want to start here in other country, is to review all the programs and start to give different different material specific of sociology, ethics, about, politics, and so on. And when you have like a machine learning program, you have like a question that you consider the social problem of if this developed technology haven't got a recognition of older people or so on. So they start to check all the program that we develop, because I think that right now we specialize in subject, but we left outside all the other things that in the past, for example, all the program have philosophy. And they start to push out why is important philosophy in engineer? Why will we take out this? And sociology, it's not. And so right now we are like this in our area, and it's surprising that I'm a sociology, I sometimes explain to another, you can check in the Institute of Statistics all the data regarding social, economical, and educative level in the area of the hospital. And they say, yeah, because they don't know. And I don't know a lot of things about engineer because I am studying sociology and la, la, la. So I think this is the moment that we start to define another way to learn and to interact and to be experts in different ways, of course, in our area, but to be conscious about the diversity and the other variables that we need to take account, because we will have consequence in all the population. Okay, not in a group, in my laboratory. No, for all the women, all the black people, all the old people. If you design a car where it's not a test for old people and or for people that are not in your objective, that a white man, you will have a big consequence. So I think it's a good moment. And we need to start with the universities and programs. This is my opinion, of course, but I think it's a good start that Harvard, Stanford, and hope that UPF and so on start to check, not just to have a course, if to in the core program, no, the curriculum change a little bit. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to say one thing now related, well, you were saying now to create things that work for everyone. And I was waiting for you to use the word minorities, as in, you know, also for minorities, because I was thinking the other day, well, we talk about minorities, but actually, white heterosexual men are the minority if you look at the whole world, no? I mean, if at the end of the day we're doing everything for a very specific demographic, which is not the majority of the world, no? So I think that you were talking about the power relationships before, no? Also, so is there? You had a question.
Yeah, sorry. I mean, we are not Harvard, we are not Stanford, but we are doing things in this direction here at UPF, and I think it's key. I mean, I completely agree with you that AI is an opportunity because it's raising some questions that nobody was thinking about them 10 years ago, and it's helping us to put together clinicians and engineers, and we are doing this in a subject, putting students from the medical school and all type of engineers, not just biomedical engineers, but computer scientists, telecommunications, data scientists, together. And when you put these people together, you cannot go super deep on the technical details of an algorithm. But that's brilliant, because then you talk about the ethical aspects of AI, the implications, the impact. And when you see the different points of view, this is great. And this should be compulsory in the next few years. Huh? And also related to this, I mean, things are changing. Now, at least in our degree of data science, 50% of people are women. And obviously, 10 years ago, you couldn't have this in engineering. And biomedical engineering is more than 60 women. So hopefully, this will be a wave that will make things change, the most important things, at the leadership levels. that this is something that, that is needed. And also AI and all this education, you were saying that it can amplify the problems, but also, I mean, the good things. I mean, nowadays, you don't need to go to Stanford to be an expert on a given topic. Kind of easily you could find material online to educate yourself. And this is going to change how people are educated in the next 20, 30 years. But we need to make sure that these debates are part of this education, or this material that they can find online easily together with the online course on Python. But they can have these discussions also for them to really understand. And the last thing, I mean, I'm super privileged, white, whatever, full professor. I have three daughters. So, I mean, obviously it's going to have an impact for me, for my life, for my family, for the people I love, if things doesn't change. I mean, so I think this is a problem for all, not only for minorities.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Oscar. I think we have one or two questions there.
Thank you very much for the interesting discussion. Going back to hiring, I would like to hear your thoughts on the so-called positive discrimination, like hiring women because they're women, like focusing only on gender, mostly. And it's because recently there was a company called Engie that I think they made the CEO, who was a woman, quit, and then they were hiring only female CEOs. And I was having a talk with this about this with my sister, and it got very interesting. So I would like to hear your thoughts on that. Do you think that's important for gender equality within an institution or a company, or do you think it doesn't work?
That's a great question and a great point. I think quotas are very, very much controversial across the world. I just only refer to an interview I heard from a CEO of a startup. They were all men sitting up on the stage and talking about their startup, and somebody asked the question, it's like, why are you guys all men? And he said, well, from the candidates, there were very few women. So that is not, that's a discriminatory answer, I believe, in my opinion, because if you want your startup to be good, you need a different perspective. So it's a need to have a balanced team. It's not like something you do to comply a regulation, or because now we're talking about diversity. You need to have as many voices you can in your team. So whether that would be a CEO, maybe that's a bit extreme. Maybe what they want is to set up the role, a role model. Because if you look really hard, there are very, very good women that could be a CEO of a company. So if they want their company or their focus to be more women, feminine, or women, female products, I think it may be a good idea if they want to change the culture of the company. So I'm not in that company enough to, like, I'm not part of the company to say why the decision on gender for the CEO, but I can explain, or I couldn't understand why they want to establish that a certain amount of people in the team, that the team will be diverse. That would be, I don't know, my opinion, but it's so, such a controversial topic that...
I can just say, so, like, I also don't have, like, a particular position I take on this, but one thing I would like us to think about is, if you look at the history of our modern world, for a majority of the time we've existed in our current civilization, there have been exclusions based on gender, race, and everything. Even if you think about, like, separation of, and this might get a little touchy, colonial states from Europe and, like, the rest of the world, that's only 60, 70 years ago. Many of our grandparents and parents were alive during those times, and because we have been actively excluding people, women, in many fields, especially in STEM, is it a problem to actually intentionally seek out these women now, if and make sure that we train at every level to get into this position? Because we're looking at a history of maybe 300 years compared to 50 years of change. That doesn't add up mathematically for me to just say, it's controversial, therefore we shouldn't have any quotas. But I think it's something that's controversial, therefore we should bring this into conversation and think about this whenever we're looking at new hires at every level. That's my own opinion.
I just want to add that I don't want to have quotas. I would like to have a society that includes naturally everyone. I think this is the point. I prefer that we eliminate quotas, and naturally they include the population in the in industry and companies. But if you check, for example, the last convention of climate, in the picture that it was published, that all the leaders that talk about the future climate measure, they are all men. I think there are three women. So nobody care about that. But when you apply something, like sometimes could be controversial, everyone like, oh my God, what are they doing? I think it's a way to start to change the structure, the statu quo. If you don't have a, if you don't have the a different action, you will have a different effect. So this is the thing right now. I don't know. I need to check this company, but right now, and there are countries like I mentioned before, Brazil, that apply quotas and have a better result right now. And naturally, they will eliminate these quotas because they will include the underrepresented group in the society. Mm-hmm. So, and change the stereotype and give more leaders, and the young generation will identify and so on, so on. And naturally, you will have the change. So this is a very, how to say, problem that there are many countries that are talking about quotas many years ago. But right now is the solution that we find to change the structure.
Mm. But just one point. I think we are balancing with the quota, all this. In addition, the maternity, right? Economically, men and women will want to hire men because you know, because of the actual regulations today, that woman is going to leave for a few months, and then she may reduce her time because it's the use or the stereotype maybe that moms will stay at home as a primary caregiver. So as far as we still have the regulations that women will be the ones that stay at home, it's better to put some quotas to encourage women to stay in the workforce. Otherwise, we will not have women working outside the house. It's a bit extreme, but...
And also to be conscious, for example, because you repeat your network. For example, when we organize this event, we think about who we can talk, invite. And of course, you think about your contact, no? Your network, and I can talk with, I don't know, Paula, that I know, and... But you need to broke your network and to go to outside. And this is why we encourage, for example, in the BSC to send the job offer in network of women in STEM, of black bioinformatician in USA, like different group to break mm-hmm. out this, yes.
Mm. But do you have a quota or no?
We have an affirmative action that say we will apply a positive balance when the group is have someone that is underrepresented. So just to explain, if the group, for example, of they are all women in the secretariat that is in administration, we will apply an affirmative action for the group that is not represented. But in the majority mm-hmm. of the case, for example, if we have a project that are all men, we will apply this. We start this year. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So just I'm going to let Oye Dia speak. Just a brief comment that I think positive discrimination, if it was compared with no discrimination when hiring, then that would be bad. But I think we are doing positive discrimination to compensate, you know, negative discrimination, let's say. So it's not that, I mean, I think I understand it is controversial, and I understand, and you have to look at case by case, no? But I think, as Akinola mentioned also, you know, we've been doing negative discrimination for, you know, so many centuries that, you know, a few years of positive discrimination, I don't think they're that bad. So, Oye Dia, what you wanted to say?
Yeah, well, the thing is that, as you said, it is very controversial, the use of quotas. And at the end, we have to think who's the best candidate in order to provide like the work that we need this person to do. And but many times, and this is something that I heard when I was attending this month the Web Summit, usually recruiters say, "How do you ask to the possible employee, how do you think you can fit in our company or in our culture?" When in the end they mean, how do you think you are? How similar you are to us? When in the end, we should try to ask the question of how we can make you stay here in order that you can provide or you can give us the best of you, and that we can learn and that we can have this asset inside of our company, which is the other way around. But this is something that involves 100% human resources. And for this, human resources also has to change. Because there are so many ways in which we can detect easily where these people, where a person comes from, like the background. For example, if you know, even if it's a blind CV, there are so many ways in which you can understand who is this person by the university where this person was studying, by the code. Code number of the place where this person is living, or even their name. But of course, if it's a CV, a blind CV, this helps a lot. But also, I think that people who are working on human resources, they should do an extra effort in order to also decolonize their minds, because they already have a mindset that it's so white, so male, and many times only trying to bring women to the table, that has to change. Because if we try to invest at least 10% of our time that we spend speaking about women to talk about other people, for example, people who are having discrimination because of the gender, because of their sex, because of the way, I mean, their economical status, their age, or the race, many other things we will for sure improve, as we've seen that has been improving in terms of adding more women in the workforce. But we see that this is something that we are just trying to tackle one topic at one time, and this is something that we should do generally, not just adding one kind of population, and then let's see if after we can add more people from other communities inside of the workforce. And in the end, to make sure that this is something that is happening, we should involve people from the board. Because if the board is not convinced about this, we are not going to do any kind of change.
Well, thank you very much, Oyedija. I think we have to leave it here because it's 6 o'clock. But I think that was a very nice way of ending the event, of, you know, this call for everyone, absolutely everyone, to be involved, no? And I think this is like a key message from today's event. I don't know if Aurelio and Natalie, you wanna say some kind of closing remarks, or yeah? Or if not, I mean, we as I said, you know, thank you very much for being here. So hopefully we'll have more events like this, more debates. As you were saying, it's important to keep on discussing these things. So thank you very much.